everyone, and welcome to a brand new skilling video. Today, we're going to be talking about a quick introduction to running Stateful workloads with Kubernetes on Azure. My name is Vaibhava Ramadas, and I'm a program manager on the Azure Storage team. On the agenda for today, we're going to be covering a quick introduction for running Stateful workloads on containers. We're then going to jump into the different storage options that we have on the platform and your considerations as you think through your workloads. And then we're going to cover a number of recent announcements on the platform and then jump to a demo to see some of the latest capabilities on the platform. With that, let's get started. Azure offers a plethora of options for running containers, including services like Azure Kubernetes Service, which offers simplified cluster management, Azure Red Hat OpenShift, which provides you a fully managed OpenShift environment, Azure Container Instances to elastically add virtual nodes when your traffic spikes, as well as our cluster API provider that allows you to run a fully custom Kubernetes environment. Kubernetes also has a rich and vibrant community in which Microsoft is a key contributor. We work extremely closely with the other members to build great technologies with the community and bring these open source technologies to you, our users. Over the last few years, we are seeing a significant increase in the Stateful production workloads that are running at scale with Kubernetes on Azure. These include workloads like databases, including MongoDB and MySQL, big data applications like CassandraDB, machine learning workloads, including Apache Spark or Kubeflow, as well as a plethora of other applications like messaging, CI/CD systems, or CMS technologies. These workloads leverage different types of storage on the platform, including block, file, or object storage options that can be leveraged using CSI drivers that are deployed and configured in the Kubernetes environments. When it comes to Stateful workloads, there are a few key considerations. First up, reliability and availability. It is super important for you to ensure that you have data durability when it comes to your production workloads. With Azure, we offer a 0% AFR guarantee, meaning that we never lose customer data. Next up, performance and scale. We offer a number of different storage options that allow you to maximize your performance for your I/O intensive workloads, and this can include IOPS and throughput, as well as do this with sub-millisecond latency. Next, simplified management. We offer you a very simplified and integrated way for you to manage your applications, including integrations for scale, monitoring, as well as data resilience and protection. We allow you to take snapshots and restore these snapshots to your environments to ensure that you always have data recoverability. And last but not least, we offer built-in security options that allow you to ensure that you have encryption not just in rest, but also in transit. We allow customers to bring their own keys so you have complete control on the encryption in the environment. Now, Azure Storage provides cloud storage that is durable, highly available, and massively scalable. We offer a range of storage services that can handle any of your data needs, so you can choose the storage that best meets your workload needs. Here you see the different storage options that you can leverage with your Stateful workloads. If you're running a high-performance database or a big data application, you can leverage our block storage option with Azure Disks. If you're looking to create shared or user workspaces or run a CMS system with a shared access, Azure Files is a great option. If you are running an analytics workload at high scale or an HPC-based application, you can leverage Azure Blobs through a BlobFuse or NFS-based endpoint within your container-based application. And last but not least, if you're running a high-scale custom application on NetApp, you can leverage Azure NetApp Files with your Kubernetes environments on Azure. In addition to this, based on your workload requirements, you can choose from different options, including static and dynamic provisioning options, as well as different access modes, whether it's read-write once or read-write many. We have announced a number of key capabilities on the platform that can really enhance your container storage experience on Azure. First up, we've announced the general availability of the CSI drivers for Azure Disk, Azure Files, as well as Azure Blobs. We enable you to take volume snapshots as well as volume cloning as part of these drivers so that you can always have data protection and resiliency. In addition, we've also announced the GA of our ZRS disk capability that allows you to deploy a high availability application that can handle zonal failures. Next, we've enabled our larger file share options with Azure Files, as well as announced a price drop on Azure Premium Files. This can really help you run production scale applications with Azure Files. Next, we've announced NFS options for both Azure Blobs, which is currently in GA, as well as Azure Files, which is currently in preview. Now let's take an example of one of our announcements with zone redundant disks. Zone redundant disks ensure that your disk persistent volumes are synchronously replicated across three different zones in any particular region on Azure. This means that if you're running a multi-zone AKS cluster, your application will always be able to use the persistent volume independent of whichever zone it's running on. This means that if an entire zone is unavailable, your application will still be available. This works great for applications that don't really have an app level synchronization. And so you can now rely on the platform to do the replication on your behalf. This is now available with Azure Disk CSI driver in GA and can be used with the premium SSD and standard SSD SKUs. You can try this now in four different regions on Azure. With that, let's take a look at a demo of the ZRS disk capability. What you see on the screen here is that we've deployed a Kubernetes instance running on Azure, and this is using the version 1.21. Now, when we look at the storage tab, we see a number of different PVCs that are running in the environment associated with different stateful applications or pods. We're going to switch over to workloads and look at the stateful set that's being deployed in this environment. This specific stateful set has a pod and that has a corresponding persistent volume. Now, we can also see this on the command line by issuing kubectl get pv, which allows us to see the different PVs in the environment. And we can see that this specific PV is configured in the context of the stateful set, and it's deployed with the ZRS storage class. Now, just taking a look at this specific disk, let's take a look at this in the portal. So this disk, as we see, is a standard SSD ZRS disk, which is configured with this application, and it is currently running on the VMSS node 3. We also see that the pod in the environment is running on the same node as we expect. Now, what we're going to do is we are going to issue a drain on this node so that we can then see what happens to the application. Now, when we issue a drain on the node, it cordons off that specific node, and then Kubernetes will move the pods and any applications that are on that node, in this case, node 3, onto a different node in the cluster. Now, when we look at the different nodes in our node pool, we see that we have a few different options here, which include node 2, 3, and 4. And so since we actually did a drain from node 3, we will expect that the pod and the application will show up either in node 2 or node 4. Now, let's give this a couple of minutes. So here we see that the actual draining process is complete. So let's go back to our workload and our stateful set. Here we see that the container creating status has changed to container creating, meaning that the application is actively being moved. And so when we look at this application and this pod, we see that this is now on node 4, which is sitting in a different zone in Azure. What we also expect to see once this pod is actually up and running is that the volume that was configured alongside this application, which is basically the PVC with standard SSD ZRS, will also be on node number 4. We'll just give this a couple seconds to refresh and make sure that our PVC is actually up and running. All right, so we see that this is live. I'm going to refresh that page. And there you go. It's actually, as you expect, on node 4 as well. So what you've really seen here is that when you create a multi-zone AKS cluster and you deploy an application with a ZRS disk configured, independent of where your pod is scheduled, whether it is on node 1, 2, or 3, your disk PV will be available to you to leverage on that specific zone. And there you have it. With that, let's jump over to talk about our partner ecosystem. On Azure, we are deeply integrated with partners that offer a number of different capabilities, including core container storage and container storage management, as well as data protection and disaster recovery solutions. We work extremely closely with these partners and have integrated solutions on Azure for you to leverage with your production workloads. With that, thank you very much for your time and for joining us today with this digital skilling session. Please check out our links to learn more about container storage on Azure, as well as please take our survey so we can continue to improve our platform. Feel free to reach out to us in case of any questions and for any references to our net new features. Thank you once again and have a great day.